beautiful. Music dumb from all my unruly notes. The distance is dissonance moving close. Now I see, erase the scales from my eyes, then play the scale of my life. Chaos played off with a chord and a chord with a source prevented through strife. And I've tasted suffering, I've been embraced by the painful buffering. I've been bound by doubt so loud right now, but a melody is made when you play these rusty keys. So we all gotta get pressed, tuned up like instruments. But I know all of life's tempo is set whenever we remember this.
Even in the madness, there's peace, drowning out the voices all around.
Jesus lifted high. Good morning, everybody. Come on, let's stand up in here this morning. Anybody ready to worship the Lord in this place today? Oh, come on, it's time to bless Him in this house. Lord, we thank You for what You're going to do in this place. Here we go.
We love to call Your name. It's something we cannot explain that happens when we proclaim Your great name, Your great name.
We love to call Your name. It's something we cannot explain.
Everything happens.
That happens when we proclaim Your great name, Your call Your name is something we cannot explain.
Everything happens.
That happens when we proclaim Your great name.
Power in the name.
Come on, who believes that today?
There is power in the name of Jesus. Power in the name.
Come on, sing it out, say.
There is power in the name of Jesus. Power in the name.
Said there's power,
yeah. There is power in the name of Jesus.
There's power, yeah.
When I call Your name,
God.
I'm free when I call.
Jesus is lifted high.
Jesus.
him high. Come on, lift him high in this place. Oh, come on, did anybody come ready to worship? Come on, did anybody wake it up now ready to give him some praise in this place? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name. We bless your name.
Well, I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. Well, I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm gonna see in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, we're gonna hear your praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he's alive.
Come on, sing it with us.
I raise a hallelujah. Let everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. And I was a darkness.
praise in this place this morning. Come on, we got to break through every barrier with our praise. Come on, we're just going to lift the roof in this place this morning, declaring that He is our God. Come on, does anybody got a shout in here today? Come on, lift your shout. Here we go. Somebody worship Him, worship Him, worship Him a moment in this place. Hallelujah. Yes, 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 yes. Come on. Come on, bless Him, bless Him, bless Him. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Just what to do, yeah.
Thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you, Lord, for your presence that always responds to the praises of your people. Thank you, Lord, for a tangible presence, a presence that we can feel and touch. God, we know you're here. We know that you're here. I thank you, Lord, for what you want to do in this place today. I thank you for freedom in this house. I thank you for freedom in our hearts and in our lives. God, thank you for freedom in every way. I thank you for setting any captive free in Jesus' name. God, I thank you, Lord, for setting the troubled heart free this morning. God, put your joy back in somebody this morning. God, put your presence, Lord, let your provision show up again in somebody's life. For the person needing healing or breakthrough in this place, we thank you, Lord, that you are going to show up in a mighty, life-changing, powerful way in this place this morning. I pray for those that have joined us this morning online. I pray, God, that your presence would be with them as well this morning, right now. Holy Spirit, would you minister to them right there? And Lord, we just thank you for this day that you have created for us to be in your house of worship. Lord, this is the day you've made. We choose to rejoice and to be glad in it. Right now, we just thank you, Father, that you're working in the hearts and the lives of your people. Thank you, Lord, that your will be done in this place today. God, your will be done. Lord, we got a plan, but Lord, your will be done. We submit, we surrender to your will in this house. We thank you, Father, for what you're going to do in each of us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Come on, if you came with an expectation this morning, why don't you put your hands together and just thank him in advance for what he's going to do in this place. Come on, come on, come on. If you're believing for a miracle, come on, if you're believing for the supernatural to show up in your life and in your situation, come on, lift your praise. Lift your praise. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, I thank you. I thank you. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Why don't you greet those around you? Welcome them here this morning to the Lord's life-changing presence today. Hallelujah.
Good morning.
I'm Jen Jackson.
And I am Meg Hanhorn.
And this is where you find all that is happening in the life of the church.
So this is the month of August, and our donations to the homeless apostle this month is going to be school supplies.
Wah, wah.
Everyone just got sad.
But the parents are happy, though.
Are they?
Well, yeah. It depends on when the school bus comes around.
Well, they're
going
to have to spend a lot of money on pencils.
Yes,
so.
They are. So grab some pencils for your children, but
pens.
Then grab some pens
really nice
for
pens.
The donation bins that'll be in the lobby.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
To help you stay connected and informed, we have two Facebook pages available for you to become a part of. The first is our Friends of Heritage page. Here you can connect with other members, share any needs or prayer requests, as well as stay informed on what is happening in and around the church. This is also where we host our weekly Power Hour, a 1 hour time of live prayer every Wednesday night from about 7 to 8 p.m. with all those who are able to participate.
In addition to that, we have our Heritage Church page where you can find encouraging words and watch either live streaming Sunday services or go back and watch the videos of services in case you missed any or simply want to hear the great word again.
So life groups are happening. And the current life groups that are now meeting are Fashion and Fierce, The Middle, Divorce Care, and Overcomers. And if you are interested in finding out about those groups and possibly joining them, please stop by our welcome booth.
If this is your first, second, or even third time here at Heritage, we want to meet you and get to know a bit about you. Take a minute after service and visit the information booth in the main lobby.
To say thank you and hello, we have a special gift just for you.
If you are here in the house with us today, you should have received a Connect card. This card lets us know you are in service and also gives you the opportunity to share any prayer requests you may have with us.
This is a great chance to get involved with the various ministries here at the church. Simply fill out the back portion of the card letting us know what interests you have, and we will have the appropriate team member reach out and connect with you. The block. There is a youth day at the lake next Sunday, August 11th at 3 p.m., and they're going to be meeting at Lake James in Virginia Beach.
Very nice.
Fun times.
Bring the bug spray.
Yes. Oh, gosh. Mosquitoes.
Mosquitoes. Next Thursday, August 15th, will be our next food distribution day. And if you weren't aware, we do have a food pantry and diapers as well. So come from 9 to 11 and treat yourself.
Treat yourself.
Or be a blessing and help some folks bring some boxes to their vehicles.
Our back to school bash. Sunday.
Bash.
Yeah, thanks. Sunday, August 25th. That's going to be one service at 10 a.m., and there's going to be water inflatables. I still don't know what that is. Giveaways, games, and it's going to be a cookout style. So just come on out and try to have fun in the most dreaded time of the year.
Bring a covered dish.
Please.
And I'm not just talking about your wife.
All right, moving on. Let's silence our phones.
And let's have a great day in church.
Yeah, the block can be dismissed. These guys are meeting today. One quick correction on that slide. We are not asking you to bring a covered dish for back to school Sunday. It's just gonna be cookouts. We're gonna be supplying burgers, hot dogs, and bags of chips and drinks. So you don't have to bring a thing, just show up. You also just wanna make sure that we have a bunch of cards that we printed up, back to school bash, for you to take, to hand out to your neighbors, friends. Where are we hitting this community? We're going to be passing those things out, inviting them. So just take a stack of those things. If you'll hand them out, now don't throw them in your car dash, but you know, if you'll hand them out, take a stack of those cards, pass them out. It's going to be a kids' emphasis Sunday. We're going to be, remember, it's once again, one service, 10 a.m., and that's the last Sunday of this month. We're going to be praying. I'm going to be speaking to the kids, and then we'll be praying over the kids as they prepare to go into another school year. We think that is so important. This is, in the past, it's been a big day for us. It's usually a powerful time of watching kids worship and just praying over them and believing that God's going to use them. You know, sometimes I think we think wrong when we think about our kids going and back to school. Oh, God, protect them, God, protect them, God, protect them. I'm saying, God, empower them to go into their school to make a difference. You know, it ain't your poor little child. No, tell your child that God has given them the strength to go in, to stand up for what they believe and make a difference in the culture that they... Yeah, I know. It might be outnumbered out there, but not really, not if God is on their side. So we're sending them, we're going to pray over them and just pray that God would empower them, send them into a place where they can make a huge difference. It's going to be a great day. Anyway, looking forward to that. Hope you'll make plans to attend. All right, ushers, if you'll come and prepare to serve our people, we're going to receive our morning tithe and offering. We have something here at Heritage called Smart Giving. It's a way to give through text. You can text a dollar amount to that phone number. You can even put a keyword in there if you like. You'll figure out how easy that is to use. And as always, I thank you for being a giving church, a faithful giving people. And just everywhere we look, God has blessed us. You know, you didn't have to. You probably had options this morning when you got dressed. You know, we don't know why you picked what you got on. But anyway, it's supposed to be a serious moment. And sorry. But anyway, God has blessed us. Everywhere we look, God has blessed us. And so it is with grateful hearts and cheerful hearts that we return the tithe and the offering today. Lord, thank you. Thank you for the privilege to give. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us. And now, because of obedience, Lord, we bring to you the tithe and the offering. Take it, use it to build your kingdom through this local storehouse. Father, we thank you for all that you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
remember going to church as an adult, right, for the first time when I started going to church. And I walk in, and the pastor was like, he said, I want you to pray with your neighbor. And I'm like, well, my neighbor don't go to this church. I don't know if you want me to... You want me to call my neighbor on the phone? That's creepy. I ain't gonna do that. Right, then they explained to me, right, your neighbor's a person sitting next to you. Listen, I'm brand new at this Christian stuff. I didn't even know you're supposed to pray out loud, let alone with this lady. I don't even know this lady. What am I supposed to pray about? Lord, help these bumps go down on this lady's face. I don't know what to pray about. I don't know what I'm supposed to pray about, right? She went first. She was praying all good, and she must have been John the Baptist's little sister or something. Praying. She was like, Dear Heavenly Father, you said in your word in the 6th chapter, the third verse of the book of Matthew, the 601st word on page 1248. Lord, you said, but seek, S is in search, E is in everywhere, E is in excellent, K is in kingdom. You are the Alpha, Nisi, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha. I'm thinking, man, she even knows his nicknames. Now it's my turn to pray, right? But I don't got the spiritual vocabulary to just, but I'm not gonna let her outpray me. So I'm like, okay, God, first of all, you are good people. You know, you are good, Lord. You are good. You are good to the last drop, Lord. Because, Lord, I just gotta obey my thirst, Lord. You know, because choosy moms choose Jesus. So, Lord, because. No, as the rocket's red glare, Lord, it gave proof to the night, Lord. I believe I could fly, amen.
Amen. We're going to be talking about prayer today. We've been in a series talking about fundamentals, the fundamentals, and... We're talking about things that are foundational to our Christian walk, to our relationship with God. And we started out talking about worship. We spent a few weeks on that. Last week we began talking about prayer. We're going to continue that today. And then in the coming weeks we're going to be talking about giving and serving. And we're ramping up for a big campaign in the fall to get you guys, if you're not serving anywhere, to find a place for you to serve. Everybody needs somewhere you can serve. Everybody needs a place for God to use you in the kingdom. And so if you feel like, well, I don't know what I could do, I promise you, you got giftings, and we're going to help you discover those. So I'm looking forward to that, looking forward to getting you guys serving somewhere. Serving is important. So anyway, today we're going to continue to talk about prayer, though. We're going to talk about prayer. And the reason is that because I have found out some people think that there are some things in their lives that if they haven't achieved a certain place, or if they haven't achieved a certain mark, or if they haven't learned a certain way to do something, they feel like that they are disqualified from being a good Christian. Prayer is one of those. People, you know, some people say, I don't know how to pray. Don't call on me to pray because I don't know how to pray. Please do not call on me to pray. And they feel like that might would hinder them from being a good Christian. But let me just, can I just tell you this morning, none of us ever qualified to be good Christians. We only qualified through Jesus. Jesus qualified us when he died on the cross. So you don't have to, I don't want you to worry, you don't have to reach a certain mark or know how to do certain things a certain way to be accepted by God. What does he require? He just requires a willing heart. And he just says, if you are willing to come, I'll teach you. This is what I'm learning about this Christian walk, that you learn as you go. You learn as you go. I shared this story last week that when I was young and a teenager, I just decided I was going to spend more time with God in prayer, and I was going to go pray an hour. And I prayed everything that I knew, every person that I could think of. I called their name out. After I prayed all that I knew how to pray, it had been about just a few minutes, and I was done. And I didn't quite reach that hour mark. Of course, that's different now. That's different. I pray more often now, of course, and I can pray for great lengths of time. Sometimes it happens opposite now. Sometimes it's like, oh my goodness, it's been an hour. I got to be somewhere. I've got an appointment. But that's how it is. You learn as you go. And so that's why we're talking about prayer. I want us to learn about prayer. Some things you have to learn, right? Some things you have to learn. Some things you have to be taught. And we need to have this mental attitude that if I'm not learning, if I'm not growing, technically, spiritually, I'm dying. Because there is no standing still place in your relationship with God. We need to have this mindset. I'm going after something. I'm going after something new. So God, teach me. God, teach me. Well, I believe that today he wants to teach us about prayer. The disciples attributed Jesus' ability to do the miraculous, to feed 5,000, to raise people from the dead, to speak in an anointed fashion like nobody had ever spoken before. They attributed it to one thing, that he had a private prayer life. And we know that because they didn't ask him, Lord, teach us how to do miracles. Lord, teach us how to break up bread. They didn't ask him to do any of that. They asked him, Lord, would you teach us how to pray? Jesus, many times in Scripture, we find that it says that he went off alone to pray. And actually, the Scripture uses the term the place of prayer. He went off to the place of prayer. How many of you know if Jesus needed a place of prayer, you and I need one too? We need a place of prayer. If Jesus had a private prayer life, I need a private one too. And so I encourage you to do that. We talked about this last week. Have a place that you pray. A certain time of the day, a certain place, if you can arrange that. Maybe you don't have a private place, but maybe you can just arrange a private time. Do it before anybody else gets up and the house gets loud. But you need a place to pray, a place daily, consistently, that you go and pray. And at the same time, we remember that you can pray anywhere and anytime. Aren't you glad you could be praying going down the road in your car, and you can just say, God, thank you, Lord. God, I need you today. Or God, I just want to worship you. You can call on his name anywhere, any place, because he's omnipresent and he's right there. Wherever you are, God is. So you can pray anytime. Anybody glad? Yes. And if you happen to miss that time of that set aside time, you can pray anywhere. I pray all the time. I pray all the time. God, I just thank you that you know what? When he walks with you and he talks with you, you can pray anytime. That's how it works. That's the Spirit of God. He's with us all the time. R.C. Sproul said this, knowledge is important because without it, we cannot know what God requires. However, knowledge and truth will remain abstract unless we commune with God in prayer because it is the Holy Spirit who teaches, inspires, and illumines God's word to us, and he does so when we pray. How many of you remember the story when Jesus made his triumphal entry and he entered into the temple, and the Bible says that he cleared out all the money changers and he said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Let me ask you a question today. Do you know what the house of God is today? The Apostle Paul said in Acts 17, he said, God who made this world and everything in it does not dwell in temples made with hands. Do you understand that God does not live in buildings? But 1 Peter 2, Peter says this, you also as living stones are being built up as a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And 1 Corinthians 3, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? What's my point? My point is this, God doesn't live in buildings anymore. God lives in men and women. Therefore, you are the house of God. You are to be a house of prayer. So God, teach us. God, help us to understand that I am to be a place of prayer. I am to be a place where communion takes place between myself and the Father. So Jesus asked the disciples, they said, would you teach us how to pray? And Jesus said, I'll teach you. He said, when you pray, pray like this. And so turn with me to the book of Matthew. We're going to look at the Lord's Prayer again today. Some call it the Lord's Prayer. Some call it the model prayer. But what we're doing today, and I want to remind you that this is a teaching session. I want to teach you about prayer. I want to teach you. I'm just teaching you. I'm telling you what Jesus said about prayer. So I want to learn how to pray as effectively as I can. How about you? I want to pray the way God wants us to pray. So he is instructing us here. Jesus is giving us instruction, and I just want to do the same today. I want to show you what Jesus said. If we want to know how to pray, we just follow his example here. He says to the disciples, when you pray, pray like this. And I want us to do like we did last week, because there's something powerful in saying and praying this prayer together. So we're going to read it off of the screens. We're going to read it. I know there are many versions. You may have a number of versions with you today in your Bible or on your tablet or phone. But I have New King James on the screens today, and I want us to read it from this version. Can we say it together? Here we go. Matthew 6, verse 9. Let's say it together. In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. If something in me just makes me want to clap or shout or give praise, can we just give God praise a second right there just for that prayer? I love that prayer. So we're just going to continue to look into these parts of the Lord's Prayer today and ask God to speak to us and teach us about that. Can you pray with me one more time? Lord, thank you today for speaking to us. And as we look at your word, God, may we learn it today. May we be changed by it. Father, just thank you for speaking to our hearts today and teaching us today how to pray, teaching us the importance of prayer, why we pray, and how we pray. And we thank you for doing that in Jesus' name. And everybody said together, amen. Amen. So we're breaking down the Lord's Prayer into seven parts. Last week, we covered a couple of those. Here's the first. The first part is this, the paternal part. The paternal part, our Father in heaven. I always thought it was interesting. You know, you think about Jesus. Jesus was God. He was, at the same time, the only begotten Son of God. But when he's teaching us to pray, he doesn't say, you pray to my Father. No, he says, you pray our Father, because he is our Father. And it's so good to know that I can call him Father. I don't have to just call him God, dear God, or oh God, or please God. I can call him Father. Why? Because that is his choice as a picture of relationship between himself and his children, that we view him as Father, that we be his sons and his daughters. Aren't you glad? It makes things a lot more comfortable. I'm glad that he's my Father and not just some distant, judgmental God. Aren't you glad that he's Father this morning? And also, when we think of those words, our Father, we remember that when we go into our prayer time, we're not just praying for me. I'm not praying for me today. We need to get out of the habit of just saying, my Father, my Father. Nothing wrong with it. I'm just telling you, Jesus said to pray, our Father. And so that makes me think, well, maybe if it's our Father, I need to remember to pray for the others of those that are in the family. I need to pray for those that are in the family. I need to pray for my brothers and my sisters in Christ. So remember that when you pray, our Father. Remember that, first of all, he is Father, and that when we pray for not just our needs, but everybody. That's number one. That's the paternal part. Here's the second part, the presence part. The presence part. Hallowed be your name. That just simply means that the Lord's name is holy. The Lord's name is holy. And I love talking about this. I love declaring the name, because this is what we decided and talked about last week, that God is so big. There is so much to our God that one name is not sufficient to describe him. And so when I begin to look at the names of God, I begin to declare the names of God. And I begin to learn so much about my God through his names. And here's another thing. What's being pointed out here to us also is that when I come into prayer and I begin to pray, what I'm doing is I'm establishing, first of all, the fact that he is God. but also that I'm recognizing and declaring His greatness and His grandeur, His holiness, His splendor, His magnificence, His glory, His majesty, and His greatness. I come into prayer talking about how good He is. In other words, when you enter into prayer, don't just walk in and say, God, this is what I need today. 1, 2, 3, 4, see you later. That's not prayer. That ain't even prayer. We enter into His presence acknowledging Him and thanking Him. David said, I enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. That's how we pray. That's how we enter into prayer. God, I enter into your presence. I just want to thank you, God, for who you are. And I begin to declare, when Jesus was saying, pray this, hallowed be your name, what do? We begin to think about the names of God. And the reason I call this the presence part is because that's how you get God to show up where you are and to manifest in a tangible way, in a way that you can feel Him, in a way that you can know that He's there. Okay, has anybody in this room ever felt the presence of God? He is, I know that he's omnipresent. I know He's everywhere, but He is a very present God. He is here, and I'm glad that we have a place where you can feel His presence. You can know that He's here. Why? Because we feel Him. We feel His presence. So when we say, holy is your name, what we're doing is what we need to do is remember all the names of God. Remember, He's too big to be summarized in one name. That's why He told Moses, He said, I am. I am. And Moses said, who shall I say has sent me? And God said to Moses, just tell him I am. So this is what we talked about last week. Whenever I need God to be in my life, He is that and so much more. So I'm just remembering that He is the God I am. I am that I am. Whatever you need Him to be, He is that. But we can also learn some specific things that He is by looking at His names. And we talked about this last week, the covenant, the Jehovah names of God. How many of you have been praying the Jehovah names of God this week? That's what we talked about this past week. Jehovah Jireh. Here's some of those covenant Jehovah names of God. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord my provider. Jehovah Rophi, the Lord my healer. Jehovah Mekadesh, the Lord who sanctifies me and sets me apart. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord my peace. Jehovah Rohi, the Lord my shepherd. Jehovah Sidkenu, my righteousness. Jehovah Shema, the Lord who is present. Jehovah Nisi, my banner of victory. See, when I come to know God through His names, when it comes time to bring my requests before Him, I don't have to wonder whether or not He's able to do what I need Him to do. I've learned that when I need provision, I don't have to beg God. I just begin to declare that He's Jehovah Jireh in my life. When I need healing, I just don't say, God, I need to be healed. I begin to declare, Lord, you are Jehovah Rophi in my life. When I need direction, I declare you are Jehovah Rohi, the Lord my shepherd. When I need peace, I declare He's Jehovah Shalom. And when I am in the middle of a fight, I'm learning that I can declare Jehovah Nisi, the Lord, my banner of victory, and I'll lift my hands and I'll begin to praise you and say, God, I know that you're going to bring me through this thing because that's who you are. I've learned it. You've got a name that even tells me you are my victory. So here's one thing that we can learn. You say, I don't have enough to pray. I don't know what to pray. I pray everything I know to pray, and I can be done in 5 minutes. Here's what you can begin to do. Just begin to make these declarations over your life. Here's a thought. How about pray these names and these declarations over your life before you need them? Declare Him to be Jehovah Jireh. Declare Him to be Jehovah Shema, the Lord who's present in your life. Jehovah Rophi, Jehovah Shalom. Just declare it all the time. That'll take up some time. And that'll bring you into intimacy with Him. As you declare Him to be these particular things, He becomes that in your life. What a powerful concept. So God will become what you can declare Him to be. So we have those first two parts, the paternal part, Number two, the presence part. So we're going to move forward today. Here's number three. Here's the priority part. The priority part. Your kingdom come, thy will be done as it is on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. See, when you pray this, you are establishing the priority of God in your life. Remember, we worship God only, We seek first the kingdom, but we worship God only. And you're going to maybe be asking for some things a little further down in the prayer. But we need to deliberately establish as we begin to establish, even if I don't get what I'm getting ready to pray for, I still am okay with that, because the priority is that I declare, thy kingdom come in my life. Thy will be done. Oh, yeah, I'm getting ready to pray for some things that I think I need. But God, I just want to say this up front. Even if I don't get those things, even if those things are not your will, it is more important to me, thy kingdom come first. Thy will be done first in my life. That is the priority. How many of you know there's so many things fighting for priority in your life? So many things want to take over your life. And that's why this can't be just a one-time prayer. You got to pray this all the time. You got to pray it every day. Lord, I want your will done in my life. Please, all the time, pray that. God, would you show up in my life? Would you reveal your will to me? Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is. As it is. Somebody say that with me. As it is. One more time, come on. As it is. So what we're doing is we're not praying something. I want you to understand this. We're not praying for something that isn't. We're praying for something that is. It's just not here. It is in heaven. So I'm praying that it will be in the earth. Do you understand that in heaven the will of God is not contested? Everything God wants, God gets in heaven. Remember the psalmist said, forever, O Lord, thy word has been established in heaven. When God says a thing, it's done. There's no battle over the will of God in heaven. The battle for the will of God is in the earth. So that's why we pray, and that's why we declare, thy will be done, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And when we do that, we're believing that the will of God will be established both in the systems of the earth and the natural world around us, but also in us, our fleshly bodies. How many of you remember that we are earth? We are earth. You came from the dust. And if your body ever gets put in the ground, it will go back to dust. So, again, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth, in earth, as it is in heaven. So we need to pray that. That's the third. That is the priority part. Here's number four. Here's number four, the provision part. The provision part. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. Notice this. It says daily bread. Daily bread. This is connected to the children of Israel. When God brought them out of Egypt into the wilderness, and they had nothing to eat, God sent quail in the afternoons and the evenings. And in the morning, he sent manna. Bread-like substance, wafers with honey on them, the Bible describes them. I bet it tasted good. I can imagine bread from heaven tasted good. I know quail tastes good, I can tell you that. I ain't never had manna. I've had quail before. But can you imagine the supply of God? But here's the thing about these provisions. They had a very short shelf life. And he told them to only take what you need one day at a time. Only gather according to the number of people that's in your tent. That's what he told them. So some people gathered more, some people gathered less. The scripture says that he who gathered much had nothing left over, and he who gathered little had no lack. And the point was this, God was saying, only take what you need for today. And the Bible says that any quail that was not taken, it turned to worms by morning. And the manna that was not taken, it melted in the sunshine. And why was that? It's because God wanted to teach them to rely on him daily. Do you understand that the promise of God for provision in your life is daily bread? It's daily bread. Why is that? The same is true of us. Because God wants to keep us dependent on him. So when we pray this, Give us this day our daily bread. We're saying, God, I trust you to supply what I need today. I'm not going to worry about tomorrow. I'm not going to worry about the coming days because I know you'll give me what I need today. You have promised to give me what I need today. Tomorrow, you'll give to me what I need then. And next week, you'll give to me what I need then. But today, Lord, I stand on the promise that I will have what I need today. Amen. Anybody glad for daily bread? Amen. And how many of you know this is not just a monetary thing? This is anything that you need. You know, God provides strength for us. God provides favor for us. God provides a discernment for us. God provides direction for us. Whatever you need today, God will provide. So if you come to a moment, if you come to a crossroads, or if you come to a place where you have need, understand, walk in it, don't doubt, just express your faith and stand on your faith. God, where is it? Because I know you have provided. I'm looking for it, God. Where is your provision? It's going to show up because he says, I will give to you daily bread. So we can walk in that. We can walk in that knowing that he will provide for us daily bread. And by the way, Jesus said in John 6, he said, do not labor for food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life. He said, your fathers ate manna from heaven and they are dead. But I am the bread of life. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. And if anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. Anybody glad for that manna from heaven? You're talking about something that tastes good. You're talking about understanding and tasting something that's good from heaven. Jesus, he's the best gift from heaven. And it kind of takes that saying, you know, you are what you eat. Kind of takes that to a new level, to a new place. Because if we eat, if we partake of Jesus' sacrifice, oh my goodness, the change that takes place in our life. And it's because I have taken and eat. Come on, he said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Right. Come on, it's when I partake and when I take and when I am nourished by heavenly things. Oh, it tastes good. Oh, it feels good. Oh, it lives good to know that I am in relationship with God. Amen. 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 So that's what we pursue, daily bread. That's why we need Jesus every day. Amen. That's why we have this reliance on him every day. How many of you know when you're relying on God, you stay close. Right. You're snuggled up tight. God, don't get too far because I'm going to be needing you today. So reliance on God, reliance on he wants to keep us reliant. He wants to keep us dependent on him. So God, thank you for daily bread, daily for bread. That's the fourth part. The provision part. Here's number five. The pardon part. Yeah. The pardon part. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. I know probably the more familiar version is the King James. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. You need to pray this every day. Every day you need to pray this because of two realities. You will often need God to forgive you. And secondly, you will often need to forgive somebody else. When I sin and I feel convicted by the Holy Spirit, I immediately, as soon as it's brought to my awareness, I immediately confess it and ask God to forgive me. And I've also made it the habit that when I'm praying, even if I am unaware of something, I'll say, God, if there's anything that I have done, please forgive me. And then let me know it. Bring it to my awareness. Let me see it because here's why. I don't want there to be anything in between me and God. Yeah. And sometimes he has to show us. Sometimes there's revelation. Sometimes he'll show us in the word. Oh my goodness, you ever been reading the word and something like bam jumps out at you and like, oh Jesus, forgive me. I forgot. Forgive me, Lord. Thank you for grace and mercy. But that is so true. And that's what happens in the word. And even when we're praying, the Spirit of God will convict our hearts. As soon as we are aware, please don't put it off. Immediately confess that sin. And aren't you glad the Bible says that if we will confess our sin, that he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from what? From all unrighteousness. To me, that means he'll cleanse me and forgive me of things I don't even know about. Right. Right. anything that is unrighteous, anything that is unlike himself, he will forgive me for it. I just need to make it a habit to be confessing. Confess your sins before the Lord. You know what I believe? I believe that God loves to forgive. I believe that it's part of his nature that he loves to forgive us. Psalms 103 says this, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. He's forgotten them. Never to be remembered again. Never to be remembered again. I believe God loves to forgive, but here's one catch. He says if we expect him to forgive us, we have to extend forgiveness to others. We have to forgive. We didn't read it, but if you were to keep reading the two verses that follow the Lord's Prayer, Jesus is kind of like adding this addendum. He's kind of like, just remember this, guys. For if you forgive, this is verse 14 and 15, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Can you be saved and not forgive? It's pretty cut and dry to me. I believe it. The word is pretty plain there, because you cannot be redeemed without your sins being atoned for. So God, if I have to forgive, if I am going to have to extend forgiveness to receive your forgiveness, then let it be. I'm not going to withhold forgiveness from anyone. We extend forgiveness because we need his forgiveness.
Yes.
Just let me say this, by the way. You understand that their sin is not worse than your sin.
Right.
Why is it that when we refer to other people's sin, we call it wickedness, but when we refer to our sin, we call it weakness?
Yes,
sin is sin in God's eyes. So God, help us to forgive. I know forgiveness is not always easy. I've been hurt. I've been done wrong. I've been lied against. It happens to everybody. It's really a challenge with some people, because how many of you know some people are repeat offenders? They'll do it over and over if we allow them to. They will test your ability to forgive. And the fleshly thing is to say, wait a minute, I done forgive you enough. No more. But Jesus had something to say about that too. When they asked him, Lord, how many times should we forgive? And what did he say? 70 times 7, what's that? 490, right?
Yeah.
I don't think I've had to forgive anybody 490 times, but I imagine that long before you get to the number 490, you get the point that you just have to forgive as many times as it takes.
Yeah.
You have to forgive as many times as it takes. That's what Jesus is telling us here. And it doesn't mean that you have to trust them. Doesn't mean that you have to forget what they did. Doesn't mean you have to invite them over for dinner and hang out with them. Doesn't mean that. But here it is. Here's what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is simply releasing them from the penalty that you have put on them. You know that you can be hurt. And deep within the inside, you might not tell anybody, but deep down, you'll wish something bad to happen to them. Or you'll wish, God, let somebody do to them what they did to me. That's what unforgiveness can take you to. That's what bitterness can take you to, such a place where you're desiring harm to somebody. But listen, that's what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is releasing them from the penalty that you have put on them. But if I hold unforgiveness. It invites the tormentor into my life. And it puts, in reality, it's, you know, we think that we hold someone in unforgiveness, that if we're holding something against them, that they're really the one being held in chains. No, I am the one being held in chains if I am the one that holds unforgiveness. I am the one being tormented. They done forgot about what they did. It ain't fair. It ain't right. I know all that. But that's how it is. They forgot what they did to you. They've probably done it to so many people, you're just one of a bunch. So why are you going to put yourself in a cell and in prison by holding them captive to something that they did to you long ago? We have to learn to forgive and to release. Because until you release them, you are stuck in that spot. You are stuck right there. If you are holding unforgiveness, then I can promise you, you are stuck right there at that address, 432 Offense Avenue. You are right there. You are stuck there. You are not going any further until you let them go. And I believe this is a word for somebody. Somebody this morning, you just need to release them. You just need to release them and let them go. Let them go. See, I'm just turning them loose because here's the reality. Here's the reality. I've got too much in me, and God has done too much in my life, and He's calling me to do too much for me to let this one little area of bitterness hold back everything, every blessing that God has for me. So it ain't worth it. It is not worth it for me to hold this thing against that somebody who's done forgot what they did. No, I'm going to release them so that I can be released from the prison that I'm in. God, teach us to forgive. And you need to do it as soon as you can. Do it as quick as possible because bitterness leaves a residue. And the sooner you let somebody go, the sooner you can be set free. How many of you know people that their hurt, their bitterness, their unforgiveness has become their identity? And that's all they can talk about. Oh, look, this happened to me. Every conversation ends up right there. I got hurt. God can deliver. Let me just tell somebody this morning. God can set you free from that memory, that past, that experience you went through. And you can now find life in Christ, but you got to let Him go. God, help us to do it in Jesus' name. That's number five, the pardon part. Just a few more here. Number six, the power part. The power part. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. I've got to have the power of God active in my life every day. God has given each of us the power and the authority to come against and be victorious over everything that would hinder the work of God in our lives. But we've got to learn that just as heaven has an assignment for us to complete in the kingdom, hell at the same time has an assignment against us. So we know that it's the tactic of the enemy to get us enchained, ensnared, to get us in some kind of bondage, to get sin somehow in our lives to where we're sinning, to where we're sinning on occasion or some more than others. But sin has a part in our life because here's the thing. I've learned this, that your power is always linked or connected to your purity. The power of God that flows in your life is always going to be in connection and in relationship to the purity of your heart. And the more pure that you live, the more power will flow through you. Because as you've probably been there, you've known the Spirit of God to work through you. You've known you've said some things and it wasn't you, it was God's Spirit. You've known you've did some things and it wasn't you, it was God's Spirit. You've laid hands on some people and God healed them and it wasn't you, it was God's Spirit. But how many of you ever did that and then went and sinned and watched that power disappear just like that? It's gone. Because purity is connected to the power of God that will flow in your life. God, help us to be pure. And so this power part, this power thing, lead us not into temptation. Lead us not into temptation. Brings me to an important question. Does God lead His people into temptation? Here's a couple of verses to contribute to the discussion. James 1:3 says this, Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But Matthew 4:1 says, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So what is it? So maybe, and this is what I think, that God does not do the tempting. It is not God who puts an evil desire in your heart. But I think that it's so that God allows us to go and face a temptation. How else do we prove that we have grown in our faith except that we face a temptation and overcome it? So what Jesus is saying to pray here, this is what I believe Jesus is saying. Jesus is teaching us to pray, God, I'd rather not, Father, I'd rather not have to face some kind of temptation. But if I do, I'm asking you to deliver me from this evil. If it's your will that my faith be challenged, that I go through a test to prove my faith, I'm just asking that you deliver me from the evil one, that I don't become overcome by this temptation. And let me help you out with this scripture because this helps your understanding. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says this, God is faithful and will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will always make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So here's what I understand. If a temptation comes my way, God has already provided me a way of escape, and he already knows that I can say no if I will lean on his strength. So that's good to my heart. It's good to my soul that to know that if I'm tempted by it, I'm bigger than it with the Spirit of God in me. Amen. And that he will not allow me to be tempted by something that I'm not able to conquer with his strength and with his help. Right. So that's why I'm praying as Jesus told us to pray. Lord, I'm not asking you to lead me into temptation, but I'm thankful that if I endure, if I face a temptation, your power and your presence is going to carry me through that temptation, and I will become victorious. Amen. As I lean on your strength. Do you understand? You can't take a step, you can't go anywhere without potential temptation. The possibility of unbelief and disobedience is everywhere. It's a reality that can be there at any time. So that's why we pray, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Last one, as the worship team comes, let me just say this too while they're coming. The more temptation that you overcome, the more power of God will be evident in your life. Did you hear what I said? The stronger you become, the more temptation you've learned to endure in his power and in his strength, the more power will begin to flow through your life. How many of you know there are some things that I can face today and overcome them that I could not have faced when I began this journey in Christ? And I am learning as I go. You are learning as you go. We grow in strength as we go. Amen? So just remember that. That temptation, maybe you're facing a particular temptation right now. Know that God has given you the ability to be victorious over it. If you will learn to submit yourself to God, resist the enemy, if you will do that, you will watch him run away from you, because the Bible says when we do that, he will flee. We're learning. Last one. That was the power part. Here's number seven. Here's the last part, the praise part. I love this part. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. So here's what we can do. After we've prayed all those other things, as you're beginning to finish up your prayer, you can end with some praise. And that's easy to do when you begin to think about, for thine is the kingdom. You know, it doesn't matter who's the mayor. It doesn't matter who got voted in as governor. It don't matter who the president is. It's God's kingdom, and he is in control. He is ruling, and he is reigning. Is anybody glad today? For thine is the kingdom and the power. Do you understand that he is the one with the power? He has all power in his hands. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. And by the way, he's going to get the glory. He's going to get the glory forever. Forever. For how long? Forever. Not just a week, not just a month, not just a season, but forever, ever and ever and ever. He is ruling, he is reigning, he is in control. And then we get to say, so be it. Amen. 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 See, amen, let me just make sure you understand that word, amen. Amen is not like what you say when you're hanging up the phone, when you say, bye, click, you hang up. It's not like, I'm done, see you later. No, amen means, so be it. I agree with it. Thy will be done, thy kingdom come in the earth as it is in heaven, so be it. So I can go, it just means I stand in agreement. I can go and I can pray all of this stuff. You are my Father. Your name is holy. Your kingdom is being established in the earth. Your will be accomplished in my life. You're going to give me daily bread. You will forgive me as I confess. And you're going to help me to forgive those that I need to forgive. You're going to be going with me. You're going to give me the power to overcome every temptation that I will face. And because of all that, I just want to give you all the praise and the honor and the glory. And I say, for thy will be done, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Let it be, God. Let it be in my life. Come on, if you can say that and agree with me this morning, why don't you stand on your feet in here? Because that's what we're going to do. We're going to go out singing this praise today. Because God is alive, he's worthy, and putting and applying this prayer to our life will bring absolute change to it. Can we pray it? Can we sing it? Come on, say, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory this. I'm not going to take a long time. I just want to ask you this morning. I believe we're learning to declare the names of God. So I'm going to ask you to this morning. If you need provision in any way, I want to ask you to come to the front. If you need provision, come to the front. If you need direction, I'm going to ask you to come to the front. If you need direction, if you need healing, I'm going to ask you to come to the front. If you need peace, I'm going to ask you to come to the front. If you find yourself in a fight, I'm going to ask you to come to the front. If you're being tempted, I'm going to ask you to just come to the front. Come on. Or if you need to release somebody, if you need to forgive somebody, if you need to let them go, I'm going to ask you to just come to the front. Come on, we're believing that God's going to do a supernatural work right here in this place this morning. Come on, I believe this is a holy moment right here. I believe God wants to do some supernatural things right here. Now, the rest of you, I wanted to ask you to just fill in behind them. Come on, I'm looking for some people that know how to pray, people that believe in prayer, people that know that God is able. I'm going to ask you to come fill in behind. Come on, just begin to expect that God's getting ready to meet your need. Come on, don't miss this opportunity. Whatever you need this morning, whatever you need, I believe that God is going to minister to your need. Hallelujah. 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 All right, we're going to pray specifically over everyone. Who needs provision? Who needs provision right now? Just raise your hand. Who needs provision? All right, we're going to pray and we're going to declare Jehovah Jireh to show up in your life right now. He already knows your situation. He knows what you're facing. He knows your need. And he is very able and willing to show up in your life right now. Lord, we just declare. Come on, everybody, pray with me. Lord, I thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh. You are the Lord, my provider. God, I thank you that right now, God, you are showing up. Your provision is showing up in Jesus' name. God, if it's a money thing, God, send money. Money cometh in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you, Lord, if it's favor, if it's breakthrough, whatever kind of provision is needed, Lord, I declare it right now in Jesus' name that you are showing up. Jehovah Jireh, thank you for showing up in every life, every hand that's raised right now. Thank you for being Jehovah Jireh. We declare it in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, just go ahead and receive provision. Receive your provision in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Come on. I don't want you to tell him what you need. He already knows what you need. I just want you to declare him to be, Lord, you are Jehovah Jireh in my life. Thank you for being Jehovah Jireh. Thank you, Lord. Who needs direction? Who's believing for direction? Who just need God to show you what's next or where you're going? Right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, right now for direction. Lord, right now we pray Jehovah Rohi right now. You are the Lord our shepherd. You order our steps. You direct our lives. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Hallelujah, Lord, I thank you that you are our shepherd. God, your word tells us that the steps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord. Lord, I thank you right now, God, that you're ordering their steps right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, God, would you order their steps? God, open doors, open the right doors, shut the wrong doors. Right now, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for direction. It's going to be so clear. There'll be no question, no crossroads even, God. One straight, clear path. Thank you, Lord, that Jehovah Rohi is showing up in every life right now in Jesus' name. I thank you for it. Thank you for direction. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All right, who needs healing this morning? Who needs healing in your body? Come on, lift your hand up high. Lift your hand up high because he is Jehovah Rapha. He is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals. So right now, come on, join with me. Come on, lift your voice. Lift your voice in this place. God, I thank you that you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals. and I receive my healing right now in Jesus' name. By the stripes you took upon your back, I am healed, declares the Lord. I receive my healing right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, that you are Jehovah Rapha in my life. You are the Lord that heals me from head to foot, in mind, soul, and body, in every aspect of my life. Lord, thank you for being my God that heals. In Jesus' name, I declare it's done. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, I see it. I see it. I see it happening on faces right here. I see the power of God manifesting on faces right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being our God that heals. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who needs peace? Who needs peace? You might be in the middle of a situation. Things can be falling apart all around you, but you can have peace. Why? Because He is Jehovah Shalom, your peace. Even if you can't understand it, even if you can't explain it, Lord, how in the world can this be happening? You can still have peace because He is your peace. You don't have to create your peace. You don't speak your peace into existence. You don't positively think your way into peace. You just declare that God, He is Jehovah Shalom, the God, your peace. So I just declare Jehovah Shalom is active. He is present in your life. He is your peace today. So no matter what's going on around you, you can be at peace. You can have the confidence of knowing that God is with you. God is sustaining you. God is carrying you. Yes, even through this situation, He is Jehovah Shalom, your peace. How many of you are right here? Let's just talk this second. How many of you are right here in the facing temptation? How many of you are in a fight for your spiritual life? How many know what it's like to be in a season of temptation where you can't get away from it, it seems? If you are in a season of temptation, if you are facing temptation, if you are in a fight for your spiritual life, do you understand that God has enabled you? He has given you the power to overcome. And you would not be facing what you're facing if you did not have the power and the strength in Him to be victorious. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to lift up the banner of victory. We are going to declare Him that He is Jehovah Nissi, the Lord my victory. That banner of victory is not some banner. Sometimes we do that in church. It's symbolic. But in reality, the banner of victory are the hands of men and women raised. So that's what we're going to do. We are going to raise our banner of victory, and we're going to declare He is Jehovah Nissi, the God, my victory. My God who brings about victory in my life. So right now, come on, if you're in a season of temptation, a season of battle, right now you just lift your hands up high towards heaven, and I say, God, I thank you that you are Jehovah Nissi, the Lord, my victory. I don't fight this in my own strength. I don't do this on my own. No, I walk in your power. I walk in your authority. I walk in your boldness. And I will declare that you are Jehovah Nissi, the Lord, my victory. Thank you for victory in my life. Thank you for victory. No more failing in this area. No more falling. Not one more time. My faith is grown. My faith will endure the testing because you will carry me through. You are Jehovah Nissi in my life, the Lord, my banner of victory. Hallelujah. 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 I thank you for victory, Lord. I thank you for victory in my life. I thank you for victory. I thank you for victory, Lord. I thank you for victory. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We're just about done. We're just about done. But come on, this is so important right here. Because this is what gets you out of stuck places. How many of you need to release somebody and extend forgiveness? about it. Think about it. Think about it. Think about it. You know what human nature does? You know what I think the mind does? For our own security and for our own protection, sometimes we go into survival mode and we forget our hurts. We know that we've been hurt. But sometime, a long time ago, maybe even subconsciously, we made the choice to forget it. And I'm not trying to go in and dig up everything that's been done to you that was wrong. But what I'm asking, I've asked the Holy Spirit to reveal to you enough that you can address it and deal with it. Because until you do, you're stuck. But when you release that person, and when you are released, now life continues. Now my calling continues. Now my assignment continues. So Lord, today, I make the choice. God, I can't do this in my own strength. Right now, would you give me the strength? Would you give me the strength? Here's what we're going to do. I know it's symbolic, but listen, here's the thing. We've been talking about being rooted. You know, righteousness shows up in your life when the roots are righteous roots. But when there are bitter roots, when there are roots that are connected to hurt and pain, you know, you can cut off the top of a blade of grass. You can pull that thing off. You can break it off every week if you want to. It still keeps coming back until you do what? Until you dig it up by the roots. You got to dig that thing up by the roots. Until you deal with your hurts and your pains, until you deal with unforgiveness at the root level, it's going to keep showing up in your life. But aren't you glad that God has given us the strength and the ability to uproot that thing? So it no longer controls me. It no longer has any power over me. That person has no power over me. Their power and their control and the effect that they have on every relationship in my life is now broken off of me in the name of Jesus. Because I'm going to pull this thing up by the root. I'm going to pull this thing up by the root. And I want you to symbolically, come on, I want you to reach down. Reach down and come on, we're going so deep right now. Come on, we're going into the depths right now. Symbolically, I want you to reach down and I want you to grab every bitter, unrighteous root. And we're going to snatch that thing up and we're going to cast it away. Are you ready? Come on, just reach for it, reach for it. All right, come on, grab it now, snatch it up and cast it to the side. You are released in Jesus' name. You are released in Jesus' name. You're not stuck anymore. You're not going to be hindered anymore. You've released that thing right now. You've released that person in Jesus' name. Now the blessings are going to come again. Now the provision's going to come. All those things, those other things that you needed are going to come because you have extended forgiveness. Hallelujah. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, Lord. I release it. I let them go. I let them go in Jesus' name. Come on. In Jesus' name. Come on. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. Let them go. Let them go. Come on. Let them go. Let them go. Let them go in Jesus' name. Oh, for thine is the kingdom and the be it, Lord. So be it. So be it. just sense healing taking place all over. All over, all over, all over. Healing. Come on, when you release healing, healing. When you release, healing waters flow. When you release healing waters flow. Come on, the devil hates it when you let them go. Just like he hates it when God forgives you. That's why he always tries to remind you of everything you've done wrong. And that's why we can always throw it back in his face. God doesn't remember that no more. Because my God forgives and forgets. God, help us to forgive. God, help us. We walk in that. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Agreement, God. Whatever you want to do, I'm in agreement. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Just waiting. We're not going to end this moment here. The Spirit of God is at work. If you got to leave, you go ahead and leave. God bless you. But we're going to keep right here. We're going to keep praying. As long as these guys want to pray, we're going to let them pray. God, thank you. Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you for the work. Thank you for the work that you're doing right now. Complete the work. Complete the work. Complete the work. In Jesus' name. 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 Glory, glory, glory. encourage you today. Type out this prayer. Keep it in your Bible. Maybe put it, tape it to your rearview mirror. Put it somewhere. Wherever you pray, begin to pray this prayer every day. I believe it's going to change your life. I believe your life will forever be changed. Because you know you're not just reciting some ritualistic prayer. There's power in every phrase. There's power in every part. So I encourage you to begin to pray this prayer. Your life will be changed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. We love you. We'll see you next time.